So it's within 5 minutes to introduce these recent guidelines, PEDIS. PEDIS is an acronym for prevention and management of pain, agitation, sedation, delirium, immobility, and sleep disruption in adult patients in the ICU. So there were 30 panelists or experts across the world with five countries. And we had the privilege to be invited as three French guys to participate to this to these guidelines. And so the main goals of these guidelines were to update the 2013 guidelines published by US and Canada teams, and to add some new insights, I mean immobility and sleep disruption, and also to make invitation for including patients as collaborators, active collaborators for these guidelines. And so I was personally involved in the pain group, where there were six of us to review all articles about this topic. So we had briefly we had one conference call per month for 4 years, and we started in 2014 by formulating questions, and then to follow an extensive process to select outcomes, to extract studies and data, to rate the quality of evidence and the quality of medical science for each study, and then to formulate recommendations before voting by the panel of experts. And in 2018, it was the publications of five articles. So we made recommendations and statements. Recommendations, there were 37, derived from actionable PICO questions, PICO for patient intervention comparison outcome questions. We made two strong recommendations. First, regarding the use of neuropathic pain medications in addition of opioids to treat pain with a neuropathic component. And the second was to not to recommend the use of volatile agents to treat procedural pain. And we made 35 conditional recommendations, meaning that these recommendations could not be viewed as downgrade recommendations, but because some of them didn't achieve the complete quality of evidence to be upgraded to strong. We also made two good practice statements, in particularly to state that in each center we need to write protocol for management of pain and sedation. And we also made 32 statements derived from non-actionable descriptive questions, for example, to review the predisposing factors for pain or for delirium. So what are the key messages? Because it will be too long to discuss each recommendation. The first was to put more attention to immobility leading to muscle weakness and sleep disruptions, because all of these two issues are the consequences of suboptimal sedation. I mean, to excessive or not controlled sedation. The second key message was to put more attention to prevent any causes of discomfort by minimizing as much as possible noise and light, by treating procedural pain, meaning with short-term opioids or non-opioid agents before procedural pain, and by reducing hearing and visual impairment for patients with these impairments. Also, a new insight was the introduction of multimodal analgesia with the use of opioids and non-opioids. So we reviewed all the analgesics that are used in the post-operative period to even if some of them had no strong or moderate quality of evidence, we decided to refer these medications because the use, for example, of acetaminophen or the use of neuropathic pain medications could be useful for some patients in terms of sparing morphine consumption and probably providing more comfort for these patients. And also, a new approach was to study all the new non-pharmacological approaches. And here is a list: massage, music therapy, relaxation techniques, cold therapy, cognitive stimulation, early mobilization. All of these non-pharmacological approaches with potential benefits in the patient during his ICU stay. So this key message overall are to consider the patient as an entirety during his stay, and as a doctors, we have to pay more attention not only on the pain, not only on delirium, but on the comfort. And my last slide is to show you the time course of the evolution of these guidelines. And in 2000, we talked about the sedation with the use of sedative, and with the CREST trial, the attention was paid to too much sedation was related to a prolonged duration of mechanical ventilation. In 2008, the French guidelines divided into light and deep sedation and divided sedation versus analgesia with proper agent. In 2013, there was the US guideline, and with more attention to detect signs of discomfort, the pain and agitation, that for the first time we also target delirium. And it was driven to improve the management of for this patient. And in 2018, so we put more attention to multimodal analgesia, non-pharmacological approaches, immobility and sleep disruptions, with two key words: management and prevention. That's an overview of these guidelines.
Thank you, Jean-François. Just maybe to summarize two points. First, this is not US guidelines, this is international guidelines.
Yes.
And endorsed by the French Society of Visus 4.
Yes, yes. There were Australia, Holland, Canada, US, and France. The countries involved in these guidelines, yes.
Okay. So, second point, it looked like at the beginning, in the 2000, we start by the basic, do not give too much sedation. And it looks like more and more we go to smart guidelines with non-pharmacological approach, with a more diffuse pain and care. What do you think about the real novelties of these guidelines?
I think that for the first time, multi-component approach for improving the comfort of the patient in the ICU has been extensively studied, and so we took time to review all the components, to including music therapy. For an intensivist, it looks like a very, very innovative or tricky, but we search and find studies about some benefits with the use of this approach for in the ICU. So by reviewing all aspects that could be proposed to improve the comforts for ICU patients, I think that the main novelty was to list several approaches, several modalities to be possibly effective in improving the comfort of the patient in the ICU. That, to me, the main point.
Okay, we have a question for a friend in Morocco who asks you, could or should we use a locoregional analgesia in ICU to decrease the opiate consumption?
Yes, if there is no contraindication, it's possible to consider Sandrol, for example, analgesia, for example, after a multiple rib fracture, and we also may consider paravertebral block. There is no contraindication of local anesthesia in the ICU, but we have also to consider that by lying the patient for days on the bed, he may be exposed to infectious complication, and for example, with analgesic with spiritual analgesia, it may be a problem. So there is no contraindication in this setting, but we have also to put in mind that for this patient, the infection is the key point.
Okay, thank you. We'll be back with you after.